Investors should stay the course and resist the temptation to take profits. So says the latest allocation strategy report from Brewin Dolphin. We're talking now to the head of portfolio strategy there, Guy Foster, who joins us with some more information about this, because it comes at an interesting time, this sort of statement. There are so many headwinds out there. We've seen the equity markets rise, and there are a considerable number of people out there that say, now's the time to sell, but not Brewin Dolphin.
No, I mean, I think when you're in a situation like we're in at the moment, that you're looking at the relative valuations of different asset classes, and logically those would tell you that the only thing you'd want to hold is equities. So naturally you sort of look into the things that might challenge that story, particularly after the run that we've had, and there are a few events coming up which perhaps you have to tread a bit carefully about. But that's that's part and parcel of a strong market for equities, that you need these things to sort of restrain the euphoria, to prevent people getting too carried away.
Well, let's take a look at some of those. I mean, recently we've seen a report, Deutsche Bank issued a report saying M&A is going to be the theme of the year. I'll talk about that in just a minute, but one of their points was that Europe has now really been resolved. But it hasn't, has it?
No, I mean, with Europe, it's going to be a long-term story, that. I mean, the union of the United States took sort of 100 years or so to come together, and I think ultimately it may not take quite that long, but we're going to be in this sort of cycle of greed and fear, really, as the dynamics of the Eurozone play out. So midway through last year, clearly there was a big structural change, the whatever it takes speech from Draghi, the removal of some significant tail risks, and that meant that it was really the right time to start betting on a successful Eurozone conclusion, and probably around about within the next few months this year, it might be worth taking the other side of that again until we see the next sort of bout of volatility run through.
Let's move on to the US fiscal cliff, which you mentioned as it's quite a considerable amount of time spent looking at this sequestration.
Of course.
How is that going to affect the equity investor?
Well, it's been interesting. I think when we came into this year, everybody had been hoping for some sort of all-embracing deal at the end of 2012 to tackle the fiscal cliff as it was then. We didn't get that deal. The can was kicked down the road a little bit further. Then it was the fiscal ceiling. The ceiling has been kicked down the road. And I think our concern really was that investors were assuming that every hurdle that is reached will be just sort of kicked aside for a few months and there'll never be any resolution. Actually, what's happened over the last few weeks and month or so is that the bear case, the idea that sequestration hits, that $110 billion worth of spending cuts hit the US economy, is now becoming the base case. So people are realizing that they're shunning their complacency and they're realizing that this is actually probably more likely than not to happen. Estimates vary, but we think it'll hit the US GDP by about half a percentage point. Mm-hmm. That's clearly negative in an environment when growth is fragile, but actually we think growth is a lot stronger now, certainly than it has been in previous years, and possibly a lot stronger than people estimate, because we have the tremendous impact of the wealth effect, of the increase in US housing, very high fiscal multiplier from the increase in US housing. It's the most labour-intensive form of industry that you can re-engineer in the US is construction. So we think it's going to have a big impact on payrolls, a big impact on consumption as you furnish those houses, and just the sheer fact that for 6 years American households have got poorer every year, and then last year they got wealthier, and because it's a geared asset that we're talking about, they got significantly wealthier as well.
Let's go back then and talk a little bit more about the equity markets and where we stand. This recent Deutsche Bank report suggesting this run-up in equity markets is going to be very supportive of new entrants into the market and also M&A. Do you think that's going to be a big play for 2013?
Well, okay, 2 points there. I mean, new entrants into the market, the IPO market is always going to be a positive result of a rising equity market. So on the basis that we think that the market's reasonably well underpinned at this level, that fewer tail risks exist, because that was a big problem last year. IPOs would come and then they'd be pulled because somebody had said something in the Eurozone and, there'd been volatility around that. We think a more stable equity market and should support that new entrance market. In terms of M&A, I think things are a little bit more nuanced. You know, in a normal cycle now, we would expect to start seeing chief executives being a little bit more emboldened, so they're looking at big acquisitions on you know, outside of M&A, they'd be looking at big investment plans, things like that. Projects which are possibly earnings dilutive in the initial years, but have sort of great hopes further down the line. The equity market psychology at the moment is still one which is much more conservative on capital discipline. So you're looking for earnings accretive transactions and investment plans. So it might be things like acquiring a distressed competitor or a peer or something like that, improving their balance sheet, and so what we'd term positive event risk. And I think that whilst that mentality remains, that's going to make for what we would characterise as sort of longer cycle of investment. Some people have talked about much shorter cycles, but we'd say it could be much longer on the basis that you're not getting that sort of excess from chief executives. Deals done for the CFO's benefit rather than the CEO's.
Okay then, so as head of portfolio strategy, let's wrap it up and bring it all together and talk about the portfolio. You like equity markets at Brewin Dolphin. Where should investors be looking then? At areas, sectors, or however far you want to drill down?
Okay, so we still retain a quality bias. So that's the point that I just made, mm-hmm. Really, that you can see companies which are in a strong position, which have emerging market growth possibilities without necessarily being domiciled in emerging markets. So I think, you know, that structural theme towards growth, which has existed for a few years now, we don't see that dissipating. On geographically, I think the US is the most interesting looking region at the moment. The new industrial renaissance that's going on there, a long stagnation of unit labor costs compared to other regions where we've seen them rising, long period of underperformance from the trade weighted dollar gives them a real good sort of competitiveness boost. And added to that, we've also got this shale gas revolution. So the cost of power in America is greatly reduced at a time when the cost of transporting finished goods is also greatly increased. So this sort of centralized manufacturing in low-cost labor regions and distribute, that model I think is going to be in remission, and it's going to be much more an idea of the sort of end market manufacturing that drives markets going forwards.
Sector-wise, you mentioned shale. Is the oil and gas sector one of the preferred sectors?
We're neutral on oil and gas at the moment, but we've been talking about a possible upgrade to that sector. You know, it's been a relative underperformer recently, and prices are sort of supported by geopolitical risk and stuff like that at the moment. So, but we think that later in the year it might start to become a bit more of an interesting story.
So the sector of choice then, or sectors of choice?
Well, we've got a few ideas, really. I mean, I think in terms of growing emerging market exposure and consumption exposure, it's things like the sort of big Western brands. So the idea of beverages, where you have all the intangible assets of a really good brand, you can lever that very effectively and distribute it to a vastly increasing market, maintaining your margins. So I think that's probably the area we're most interested in at the moment.
Okay, Guy. Well, thanks indeed for dropping by. It's a fascinating report. And as I say, investors should stay the course and resist the temptation to take profits. That's the word there from Guy Foster, who's head of portfolio strategy at Brewin Dolphin.